Well, good evening, everyone. Welcome to the Foxborough Public Schools School Committee meeting of March 9th, 2021. It's now 7 o'clock, and we'll begin with our first item on our agenda, which has been the case for quite some time for open public comment. During the time since our last meeting, we've had 5 submissions to our inbox. The first from Catherine Bates of 10.5 West Leonard Street. We had a submission from Carolyn O'Toole of 55 Alden Street, Jen Prescott of 110 Summer Street, Jeff Scott of 6 Mackenzie Lane, and Jessica Yucatonis from 9 Comey Ave. Thank you for those submissions. And as has been the case for about our public comment, each one of these has been forwarded to the school committee members and they've received them all. Next on the agenda is the approval of minutes, and looking for any one of the members of the committee to questions or for the minutes.
Richard?
Yes, Tina.
I just had one thing under open public comment. It should be Ms. Dawn Steidel-Harrelson, not Mr. That's all, but should be changed.
Thank you. Noted. Thank you very much.
With that change, I'd be happy to make a motion to approve the minutes of February 23rd, 2020.
Thank you. Motion by Tina, second by?
Seconded.
Michelle, seconded by Michelle. Any further discussion about the minutes? Seeing none, we'll do a roll call vote. Tina?
Aye.
Rob Canfield?
Aye.
Michelle?
Aye.
I don't see Brent yet. Brent, are you there? Don't see him yet. And Richard Pearson, aye. 4-0 approval. Thank you very much. Next on our agenda, always great to have at the beginning of our meetings and kick off our meetings with our teaching and learning highlights. And I believe we're going to have IGO in action. And Dr. Burgos, I'll let you introduce all the people attending. And thank you for being here.
Love to do this introduction. So what you're going to see is a video here in a couple of minutes or less. And Ms. Kate Campbell, who is the principal of the IGO school, this is something that's been taking place all year. And it really is a snapshot of what schools have looked like in this very historic year. And what you'll see and what they're going to be sharing with you is just, it's priceless. It really is. And I know Ms. Katie Young, who's the math specialist at IGO, she's played a tremendous part in this as well. But just the ideas behind what you're going to hear and see about is something that I think is going to stay with you for a very long time. So I'll turn it over to Ms. Campbell and let her give you a little bit more of an idea of what's behind this.
Sure. Thank you, Amy. One of the things that I feel very lucky about as the principal is that I get to go into all of the classrooms at IGO, and I get to see the kids and the teachers and the amazing things that are going on every day. One of the challenges we have this year is really that camaraderie of going into each other's classrooms and the book buddies and the pairing up and those things that we've had in the past. So what we've done is we've done a modified version. In the future, we'll go back and we'll do school-wide assemblies for these types of things, but we have 4 of them scheduled. This is our second one that we're going to show tonight. And we have a third one that is in the making that we will show next week. But what we do is we show this all at the same time in our classrooms. And what you will see is a piece of the video that we did back in December. And it really is showing the teachers what is going on in other classrooms, as well as the kids to be able to see what is going on in all the other classrooms. But what I want you to all really notice tonight is that not only are you seeing what learning looks like, and it is a little bit different this year, but I really want you to look at those smiles that you are going to see behind the masks. Big shout out to Katie Young. I was the one I went to her in the beginning, and I said, Katie, I'd really like to do this. I don't have the skill set. Can you make this magic happen? And she said, Kate, absolutely. Let's do this together. And she takes the pictures, she puts them all together, puts it to music, and together, we've really, and with the teachers' help too, we've been able to show what IGO in action looks like. Thank you, Katie.
Hi, everybody. Mrs. Campbell here. Today, we are going to have our second school-wide slideshow. I'm so excited to see the smile, the laughter, and the hard work that happens each and every day in every single classroom, in every single corner of our school. Staff, I couldn't be any prouder to be part of your team. Students, I love watching you. I love watching you learn. I love watching you be kind and courteous. I love seeing you see what you're going to determine is your next learning opportunity. So again, sit back and enjoy the show. Let's watch IGO in action.
You've got a friend in me. When the road looks rough ahead and you're miles and miles from your nice warm bed, you just remember what your old past said. Boy, you got a friend in me. Yeah, you got a friend in me. You got a friend in me. You got a friend in me. You got trouble, and I got them too. There isn't anything I wouldn't do for you. We stick together, see it through, 'cause you've got a friend in me. You got a friend in me. Some other folks might be a little bit smarter than I am, big and stronger too, maybe, but none of them will ever love you the way I do. It's me and you, boy, and as the years go by, our friendship will never die. You're gonna see it's our destiny. You got a friend in me. You got a friend in me. You got a friend in me.
Hakuna Matata. What a wonderful phrase. Hakuna Matata. Ain't no passing craze.
It means no worries for the rest of your days. It's our problem-free philosophy. Hakuna Matata.
Why, when he was a young warthog.
When I was a young warthog.
Very nice.
Thanks.
He found his aroma like a certain appeal. He could clear the savannah after every meal.
I'm a sensitive soul, though I seem thick-skinned. And it hurt that my friends never stood downwind. And oh, the shame!
What a
change in my name!
Oh, what's in a name?
And I got downhearted!
How did you feel?
Every time that I...
Hey, Pumba, not in front of the kids.
Oh, sorry.
Hakuna Matata, what a wonderful phrase. Hakuna Matata, ain't no passing craze.
Love it.
Oh, that was great. Well done.
Thank you. A real testament to the teachers. When you see the kids in action, it really is exciting. And even though it has been really unprecedented days, the teachers are making the learning and the smiling and the growing all happen. So the shout out is to the IGO teachers, as all of the Foxborough teachers are doing such an amazing job.
Thank you so much. And Katie, thanks so much for stepping up. The efforts in our buildings to bring everyone together is not just from leadership or from students alone, but the teachers stepping up to help us in all those efforts. So it's just a huge benefit to have your ability and your skills to show all of the faces of the building. So I really appreciate that. Thank you, Katie. And I also figured I would observe that I've just found 20 new places to go read. So, and one of them is including in a laundry basket, of which I'm really confident that I do not have one in my house that's big enough. Any other comments from the committee or questions? Rob, please, and then Michelle. We'll go Michelle second. Rob?
Yeah, so thank you. I want to thank you for sharing that with us. I was pretty much smiling from ear to ear the whole time, just watching all the kids. So I appreciate everything that you guys have done. I really appreciate you sharing it. Katie, thank you for your assistance in putting a lot together. And Kate, thanks for your leadership. In a new system, in a new school, in an extraordinary year. So thank you for sharing it.
Michelle.
I agree with everything that both Rich and Rob have said already. What I loved is you could see the kids smiling even though they were wearing masks, which is great to see. And sometimes we have to remind ourselves that you can still see a lot of expression from kids, even though they are wearing masks. So that was great to see them all looking very comfortable. Mm-hmm. So thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Michelle. Tina, I think you also, yes.
Yeah, I agree with all of my school committee members who have spoken before me. And it's just so great to see the kids in the classroom with their teachers doing school. I mean, having fun, learning, being creative, wearing costumes. I saw pajama day in there. It's been a real year. It's been a challenging year and it's been a different year, but there was some normal in there. And in this abnormal year, it was really great to see the normal elementary school stuff that we just love to see. So thank you for sharing. It makes me happy. I could have cried, actually. Happy tears, but very nice to see. Thank you for sharing.
Thank you for watching. We enjoyed making it. I know the kids and the teachers and the whole school enjoy watching it. We'll continue doing these throughout this year, and then we'll get back to the point where we can sing along with them. We're not there yet, but we'll get there.
Thank you again, Kate and Katie. Thank you so much. Dr. Burdus, anything you'd like to close with?
When you think about the students being able to see that, they always love to see the pictures of themselves. Mm-hmm. So I can just, picture them watching that with their school assemblies in their rooms that way, and just getting really excited and with seeing their friends in the pictures. And I think too, it gives that video journal for the year where it's being multiple times during the year to be able to look back. It's a great keepsake too. And it'll be interesting to watch from the beginning of the year to the ones that you do at the end of the year.
Yeah, great. Yeah, well said. Yes, well said. Thank you. Thank you. Again, thank you, Katie. Appreciate you coming out tonight and Kate as well too. So thank you so much, both of you. Next on the agenda for tonight, We're ahead of the clock. Look at that, guys. We're doing good. Keep that going. Knock on wood. Is the superintendent's update. And just before the superintendent begins, I wanted to inform the committee that after speaking with the town manager, we have confirmed that we can resume the option for town meetings at the town hall. Of course, we will have to follow all of those guidelines that are set forth. So our next meeting, we will be able to plan that opportunity for an in-person option. So I just wanted you to know that and appreciate the work of Dr. Burroughs and your communication with the town manager in order to facilitate that. Much appreciated. And Dr. Burroughs, your update, please. Thank you.
Sure. So the first update, I have about five quick things here. And the first one is on the DESE guidance that was updated for singing. And we're really excited that we were going to have, if you remember at the last school committee meeting, you were going to pen a letter from the school committee to support singing and chorus to be able to be done indoors where they've not been able to do that all year. And we've now received approval for schools to allow singing indoors for in-person. And singers, you know, we have to obviously follow all of the protocols, and there's additional safety protocols in place, such as, you know, wearing a mask for sure, but being 10 feet away and being able to think about things like singing volume and lowering volume and the limiting of how long we're singing. But it's not just chorus. We talked about how even in kindergarten, how it impacted our teachers. When we think about the curriculum and what we do, like, what do you mean that we can't have kindergarten singing songs and those things? So we were really excited that we're going to be able to have students singing back indoors. And again, want to thank Ms. Jury Penders and Ms. Ernst as far as their work and going forward and trying to really advocate for the music department too with the Department of Ed and even the public comment part. I know that Ms. Ernst, she did such an amazing job there. And it really is so many people advocating for the arts. And it's so important because we know how important it is for our students. So just really excited that they're able to sing indoors. We think about the weather outdoors now. We continue this, we'll be able to have even larger spaces because it is still a challenge. And we have to remember that to be 10 feet apart indoors in our spaces and even moving to larger spaces, it's challenging, but we're willing to meet any challenge because we're so excited that they're able to sing again indoors.
Thank you. Well said. Thank you.
Fall 2 athletics has begun, and we are in a third week as far as the prevalence rate in Foxborough being in the yellow, which is different when we think back to the winter season where we were in the red all along, and that had ramifications for us when it came to spectators. So spectators will be allowed in following the EEA guidelines, and then we have the support of our local health officials. We continue to meet with them pretty much weekly, it seems. And those guidelines and the spectators sports for sports has been sent out by Joe Cusack, the athletic director. It includes two adults and siblings as far as being able to participate by watching. We'll have spaces marked off on bleachers. As we know right now, it's football, it's volleyball, it's track, and cheerleading that's taking place for the fall too. If we do have inclement weather, which doesn't seem that way now, if you were outside today, that could end up impacting the football field as an example. We had some real worries when thinking about the bleachers back when we had all of the snow and ice and clearing those. But fortunately, it's been cleared. The field has been cleared, and we'll be following all the strict guidelines for spectators there. The league, the Hockomock League, has agreed to no road fans, so that way we can accommodate our own families of our own athletes. So we will be following those guidelines and are able to do that. Again, with the prevalence rate being lower, we're really pleased to see that that's made a difference for our spectators. The third update here is on MCAS testing. This is still scheduled from the Department of Education. And it is a window that has moved slightly for elementary. We do not have the dates yet for middle school, and we have them for high school. I bring this up because I think it's important to think about where MCAS did not take place last year, and it is a competency determination for our high school students. We have doubled the testing for our sophomores and for our juniors. And the testing window for the high school, not only do you have MCAS, but we also have advanced placement testing. As you know, we have a robust AP program with hundreds of tests that are administered. And so trying to juggle the AP testing with MCAS testing, it's going to really kind of disrupt our schedule for the high school. And we're going to talk a little bit later on in the next agenda item about return to school. And I will preface this by the preview is that at this point in time, we expect to have all students back full in person. And with the testing going on at that point with all students back, the schedule itself for the high school, they've scheduled, meaning the Department of Ed, over a 4-week time period. We really feel that it's important to be as least disruptive as possible to our students. And so that way we can get back to learning and our own curriculum and what we feel is really important. With that said, instead of taking the testing over a 4-week period at the high school, we're looking at collapsing that to a 1-week testing period. There's a whole host of reasons for that. Some of them have to do with technology. As an example, we no longer have the labs. We now have everyone on laptops. And so they're drawing on access points. And although we've added many, many more access points, to have all students across the district testing at the same time, drawing on the Wi-Fi with the laptops, we have to think about that from a structural standpoint. And then obviously from a standpoint of being least disruptive. So with that said, the high school, we're looking at the first week of May for testing instead of interrupting 4 weeks of learning. And in order to have all of our 10th and 11th graders who would be testing again because it's a graduation requirement, we are going to have multiple places across the building, which requires multiple proctors. In order to accomplish that, we need to have just those students in the building at that time, which would mean those that are not testing, our 9th graders and our 12th graders, unless they're taking AP tests, would not come into school until 10:30. So it would be essentially a late start for those 4 days in order to accommodate the 286 students that would be testing at that time period. So we would run our buses as normal for regular arrival in the morning for students that would be coming in. And then we would run a second bus run for high school students that needed to be picked up in order to arrive at school for 10:30. Everyone else is there for the rest of the day and it would be a regular dismissal. It really was the creative thinking of the high school and with the guidance department and finding a way to be least disruptive in order to have students in a best testing environment that we could have them in. So in order to have that, students that would not come in until 10:30 in the morning, they would be doing asynchronous learning until they came in. So I'll stop there. That's a lot of information about that schedule for the high school. Any questions on that or need clarifications? Obviously more information and details will come out from the high school, but I wanted to go ahead and preview that a little bit. If you think back to when we were talking about MCAS testing that was going to take place in January, we were talking about cohort A coming in at one time and cohort B and having to spread that across a 2-week time period.
Mm-hmm. Right.
I mean, Dr. Barrows, with the, and I, with the jockeying that you all have done to condense this, and I appreciate condensing is better than rather than drawing it out, but is there a sense of how much of our spring quarter / trimester time will be spent devoted to testing, understanding that it's not the district mandating it, but rather the state? Because I do know that we had discussions as a group, as a committee, and as administration in the fall about our own feelings at not wanting to have 20 to 25% of the rare learning time we have devoted to standardized testing.
So what we've always, you know, said in Foxborough is that if we are teaching the standards, MCAS will take care of itself. And we are not going to focus all of our time and energy on MCAS.
Right.
We're going to focus on the standards and the curriculum that we teach. I will also say I reversed it as far as the number of students that are not in the building. It's 280 students. I reversed the numbers as far as that. Which would probably make more sense when we think about the number of students that we're testing.
Thank you. Any other questions?
Sorry, Richard. I would also add, Dr. Burdos, that for our younger learners, they have reduced the number of subtests that they will be participating in during this testing period. So that is alleviating some of it.
And if we see that the Department of Education does push off MCAS and to another time period, say into the fall, then it wouldn't disrupt our schedule. We would have a regular schedule.
And then if I could follow
Brent,
up.
Brent, one second. Michelle, please. Thank you.
I would say, Brent, go ahead and follow up.
The follow-up. Sorry, Michelle. I appreciate your patience. It's needed in my life. when it comes to those juniors and seniors who maybe need to retake MCAS, has anything changed for them?
There's a number of supports that have been put in place, particularly with this year and having the hybrid model. The name of it's escaping me. I don't know, Dr. Mello, if you remember, as far as the not SOAR, but anyway, there's been emphasis from the guidance department really focusing on students that are struggling, which is what we always do, but it's obviously heightened this year. And the test itself and looking at those students and who may be struggling even more, additional supports are provided for them in different ways. We have different tutors that are in place and scheduling students specifically when we know that they are in need of that additional support.
Thank you, Michelle, please.
Thank you, Rich. So thank you so much, Dr. Burdos, for kind of giving us that overview. I think it's really helpful. And just to kind of ask that question that I'm sure some parents at home are wondering. So the juniors who would have otherwise taken MCAS tests in their sophomore year, so are they now in that week timeframe taking the tests that they would have taken sophomore and taking tests that they would have taken junior year?
Yes, so it's all of our 11th and 10th graders, and then the other for 12th grade would be for AP. But the AP schedule is different. There are some APs scheduled during that first week, but they get scheduled all the way through May and into June, depending on which AP exam students are taking.
Okay. So if there's a double up where a child's taking an AP class, AP exam during that week, are they still taking the MCAS as well during that time, I assume?
The high school, as far as they have a makeup day too. So like you have the 4 days of testing and then you have a makeup day. We don't need to disrupt that makeup day with having them come in at 10:30 because the high school has said that they'll be able to figure that out. So that way, whatever the schedules, because you could have someone that's even absent too, regardless of the testing conflict.
Right.
So we wouldn't have as many, say, 10th graders that are taking AP classes anyway.
And thank you for kind of giving that explanation. And I do, I appreciate, and I know that other parents do as well, is the school continuing to look at things from a creative standpoint and maybe, you know, being willing to do things a little bit differently with the kids' interests in mind. And I'm sure kind of balancing sort of as a parent looking at it, saying like, okay, a full week, that's a lot of testing. But it's kind of getting it over all at once rather than having it every week for a month time frame. So, you know, thank you very much for looking at it from an overall perspective that way.
And that goes to the high school. And they came up with a number of different proposals of how to make it work. And they wanted to really be least disruptive to the whole educational program. And we honestly would really hope that we didn't see MCAS, you know, on the schedule at all. And it's the Learning Center, as far as the name of the.
Thank you. And that's the state that's being mandated by the state. It's not something that the school board or the school department has really any control over. It's coming from the state. So thank you.
Brent.
Dr. Barros, you and Dr. Mello had talked about some of the modifications that are happening with MCAS. If you could, just for our families at home, what's the latest on any modifications or moves, I guess, College Board is taking regarding AP testing in part of this year, if they've decided anything.
You know, the only thing that the high school would be able to speak much more specifically about it, you know, I've obviously looked at the schedule in which classes, you know, take place. You know, some of the things that we're having to manage as well is, in the past, we've had up to 100 students take the AP test offsite in other areas. And at this point in time, we have them scheduled for the high school. So to have the additional tests taking place in the high school to where you are able to not have it concentrated in, say, one wing of the high school because of bandwidth issues, right? Because that could overload. And then at the same time, just passing in hallways with classes that are taking place at the same time, we want to make it the best environment we can for our students. They've always been very successful, and we want to make sure that we're providing an environment where they can be successful.
Mm-hmm. They've also extended the window of time for the AP so that there is a little bit more flexibility than typical. That being said, last year with the closure, it was more of a condensed version of the test. They don't seem to be doing that this year. At least if they are, I'm not aware of it. As Dr. Berto said, the high school are the experts on this, but that's my understanding.
Thank you for that. Kiara, I'm going to come to you in 1 second for something. But Michelle, I wanted to thank you for pointing that out about the administration taking into consideration the entire dynamic of the school community. And I think it is important to highlight that, especially for the viewers that are tuning in this evening, that my impression of thus far this year is that we have been thoughtful, cautious, and patient when we could to do the right things for the entire community at all times. And so I've really appreciated that. I've never felt rushed. I guess I shouldn't say that. That may be unfair. Sometimes we felt rushed, but I never felt it was done haphazardly. So I think that is what is happening here. And we're thinking now in March for that challenging week of scheduling in May for a high school building, which is not simple. But Kiara, I wanted to ask you if you wouldn't mind commenting on that piece right there. Have you been comfortable this year as well in understanding that these plans and all these unique circumstances have taken into consideration you and your students and your fellow students in the building?
Definitely, for sure. It's very comforting to know that all of you guys put so much time and effort into making sure that we're going to be safe as well as getting our academic needs met. So I really appreciate that, and I have felt very safe and kept well in the loop as well.
Thank you very much for that. Appreciate that. Dr. Berto, is anything else for you?
I just had one last update, and that has to do with graduation. So we are obviously going to be receiving guidelines from the Department of Ed on what graduation can look like. We've not yet received that. They've said that they will be forthcoming. But more importantly for us, our graduation is on Sunday, June 6th. But just wanted to also have families, if we have to have rain, that our rain date would be on Saturday, June 5th at 2 p.m. And we feel like, you know, by Thursday evening before that weekend, by looking at the forecast, we'll have an idea, but where things would be outside, we have to consider having a rain date as well. So it's Sunday, June 6th at 2 p.m., but our rain date, should we need it, would be Saturday, June 5th at 2 p.m.
Well, that is very unique, but thank you for telling us that. Thank you.
And that is just updates. The only other update, and then this actually might be better for Mr. Yukna, if he wanted to give an update. We had school building committee meeting today, and if he wanted to give a little bit of an update on the borough.
So we're through the first two phases, which basically gets us most of our classrooms completed. We have our last six or seven classrooms that are in construction right now. We still are using the gym as temporary classrooms that will not be completed until this summer timeframe once the classrooms that are in phase three are completed. We're on schedule, but very tight. We're concerned, obviously, in some of the delays we've had along the way here. We are trying our best to give the contractor every advantage they can. Michelle and her team, teachers, have been great as far as opening and getting out of rooms as quickly as they can. I think the patience and the working relationship that's been there has been great. And so I think what we're hoping is that come back to school next year, we're 100%. We do have a very, very significant project in totally gutting the cafeteria kitchen and rebuilding it from ground up. And also, obviously, as I said, the gym, dismantling the six classrooms that are in there and putting in the new gym floors and stage area. So quite a bit of work to do over the summertime, but we're confident that we've given them a lot of advantages time-wise to keep this moving forward. Michelle and I have worked on looking at the school as far as bringing all the kids back. We're going to open up one of the playgrounds that we haven't been using to give some more space for that. And just kind of going through the whole building and just making sure we have everything that's safe for their return. And we're comfortable that that's going to work right. So I think at this point, on schedule, tight, and looking forward to getting a lot done over this summertime.
Thank you for that update. And I see Michelle's on this call. Michelle, thanks for that little tour you did, that video tour, running around the building and sprinting from classroom to classroom. I thought that was great.
Thank you. I'll give Kiara, when it's all done, I'll show you around your old stomping grounds, okay?
Thank you. I think we're all set for superintendent's update. Yes? All good? Thank you. Great. Next on the agenda is the a discussion about the return to full in-person learning update. And I wanted to welcome our three elementary principals on the call, Michelle McCarthy, Michael Stanton, and Kate Campbell again as well. And Dr. Burdos for your lead.
All right. Mike Weber, will I be able to share my screen? So I just have some slides to kind of go along with this discussion. Great. All right, is everyone able to see my screen? Okay. So we are in almost, we're in March, obviously, and it has been almost a year from that fateful day of March 13th when we closed schools and things changed and lots of planning that's taken place since then and then obviously throughout this school year. So I'm really excited to be providing this update this evening on a full in-person return. It's going to be a 30,000 foot view, if you will, update to be able to also have the committee answer, ask questions, and having the three elementary principals on with us this evening too, if there are questions more specifically for them. So our goal all along through all of our planning has been to return students back to school in our brick and mortar buildings without remote learning for in-person instruction as soon as it's safe to do so. From last spring through the summer, through the fall, if we take a quick look back, these are just a handful of the guidance documents that we have used and that have been updated throughout the school year and have caused us to pivot in many different areas. And then as measures have changed, to be able to adjust to those. You'll see that there are some that have been revised multiple times when we think about transportation as an example. So that is an update that took place on February the 11th that I had mentioned that the capacity has now been lifted. We've had about a third, well, currently we have about a third of our buses full with students because of the limits on capacity. With the updated guidance on February 11th, that lifted the capacity as an example. And then we'll talk more specifically about the guidance on in-person learning and student time requirements that was released today. And if you remember back in December and January, we talked about student learning time and some changes that had taken place and changes that we made at the middle school and high school level based on those requirements. Our planning is ongoing. We are planning constantly, although we had three plans ready for the beginning of the school year when you voted for us to begin in a hybrid learning model because of the prevalence in the community and what we knew at the time. We are constantly assessing and reassessing where our prevalence rates are in the community, looking to see if we have transmission in schools, looking at what are our health and safety practices and how those could be more efficient, or if we need to increase them in different areas. We've met and talked a lot as far as athletics and the changes that have taken place to make sure that we are ensuring that safety is always our number one priority. We followed all of these updates from the Department of Education, all the health and safety guidelines, and then in many cases, we've exceeded what the guidelines are. That has to do with when it comes to health and safety, when it goes back to the HVAC studies that we had done at the beginning of the school year, the additional custodial staff, and there's just, it really is countless, the different precautions that we've added in addition to what just the requirements were. And then surveys throughout the year that have informed our planning as well, from faculty and staff and from parents, virtual town hall meetings that we've had, and then here most recently, virtual staff meetings last week with our middle school, high school, and elementary faculty and staff. I have this slide here just as a reminder. If you think back to all of our subcommittees and planning for the school year, we had a number of different committees, and one of them was our Health, Wellness, Safety Committee. And you can see there the list of folks that were there. With our Board of Health, our local health officials have played such a critical part with us. They met with us weekly throughout the summer, and they've continued to meet with us monthly, if not bi-monthly. And now it's really been, we've been meeting weekly, whether it's with athletics, whether it's a full return to school for in-person learning, or chorus as an example, and really making sure that we are touching all constituency groups as far as what are we needing to plan for and to think about. So those particular people on this list, sometimes it's a smaller group. It's our athletic director, Joe Cusack, along with all of our local health officials, myself, Bill Yugna, and Jen Rosenberg always is our nurse leader. And then sometimes it's a smaller group depending on, I can tell you we're meeting tomorrow again because we're going to be talking about activities for students, particularly some of our, for our seniors, and what can we do within safety is always our priority. But this committee, they advise us and help make recommendations on issues of health and safety, and have played a critical part. And here most recently, as we look to returning all students to full in-person learning. Vaccinations for teachers, you've seen in the news that teachers are now eligible as of March 11th to be able to receive their vaccinations. From the federal level where teachers were made eligible, that has been great with CVS as an example. Teachers have been able to make appointments and start to get vaccines now, and we're starting to see more availability, and so more teachers are able and staff members are able to get their vaccines. We know from the staff survey that we sent out that 50% or you know, thereabouts, it was depended on the school a little bit more in some cases, felt comfortable returning without the vaccine at 3 to 6 feet, which we'll talk about as far as being the social distancing in classrooms. But we also know, and understandably so, that all of our faculty and staff will feel much more comfortable if they've had the vaccine before returning in person with schools. So we also are waiting to see what dates will be set aside for mass vaccination sites that are expected to be designated specific days for educators and staff and those working in pre-K to 12 education settings. And this is really important. This is not just teachers and educational assistants, it's food service, it's custodians, it's our bus drivers, it's everyone, it's substitute teachers, everyone working in our schools to be able to have the access to the vaccinations. And the more that it becomes available and the faster that we can have that rollout for our staff, the more important that is for that comfort level and returning to full in person. So the survey data from our families, I have a couple of slides here that I wanted to share. So the first question here was going back to that social distancing, physical distancing in classrooms. So a full in-person model, and this was also talked about and presented the same question back in the beginning of the school year to families and staff. that if we were full in person, then that means that physical distancing in classrooms would be between 3 to 6 feet. As you know, in our hybrid learning model, we have students spaced in classrooms at 6 feet. In the high school, in some instances, it's slightly less depending on the class, but it's essentially 6 feet in all of those locations. But it's really the other mitigation strategies that we've had in place along with that, staying home when you feel sick, wearing a mask that fits well. The cleaning protocols, all the additional protocols that we've had in place, our effective ventilation through HVAC work that we did to make sure that we were good to go at the start of the school year. The hand washing and sanitizing and having all of those stations in every building, down hallways and classrooms. At the beginning of the school year, when we had the Department of Education guidance, the American Academy of Pediatrics, along with the World Health Organization and the Department of Education, had said that social distancing of 3 to 6 feet, when it is along with the other mitigation strategies, that it is safe for in-person learning. The hard part about that was the CDC guidance that stated 6 feet for social distancing. So when we asked that question at the beginning of the school year, if families were comfortable with sending their students to a full in-person model if it were 3 to 6 feet, we only had about 2/3 of families at that time that were comfortable. At this point in the year, we've learned a lot. We've seen what our own data looks like in Foxboro, that we've not had the transmission in schools. So as an example, when we have had positive cases through the contact tracing that takes place with our nurses, we're able to go back to see, did we have anyone else that ended up becoming positive as if they were a close contact? And we have not had evidence of that. That has also mirrored the evidence across the state and not seeing the transmission in schools, and schools are safe places to be. So this question of our families, and would you support students returning if we were at 3 to 6 feet? These are the results here. 96% of our families, elementary families, said yes, they would support this. 95% at the middle school and 98% at the high school. And then you have the participation rates there as well, so you can get an idea of the families that participated in the survey. I will say that after the survey was administered, there were two themes that came forward with comments from families that that came to me. And one of them was, it was a black and white survey. You did not ask us if we would prefer hybrid learning going forward. And that is true. And the reason for that is the goal is to have all students back full in person. And we also know that the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education is not going to be counting in the future remote learning or asynchronous learning, the learning that takes place when students are not in the building, as part of learning time that counts.
Because we don't have a hybrid model anymore. You're talking in regards to the hybrid model, right, Dr. Bertos?
Correct, yes. So in fairness, I understand families that said you didn't give us the choice. It's either we're in or we have to go fully remote if we are not wanting to support this and not being able to have the option, because we don't have that option going forward. The other comment that came forward was not having an opportunity for like the open comment boxes and to be able to share that information. I can say that many people have come forward in email and have shared thoughts with me as well. And some of those thoughts have been, thank you so much for the survey. It felt like Christmas at my home when we got this survey, because my students can't wait. My children can't wait to get back in school. Some said, I really support this, but I'm nervous. We completely understand that. We know how important it will be to talk with our families and to let them know of the other mitigation strategies and things of what it will look like in schools. And at the same time, talking with our students about that. So it's important to remember that it's going to be a change for students. It's going to be a change for staff and faculty, and that we're going to be there to support along the way. If families are fully remote, they can stay fully remote. And we'll talk about that a little bit more specifically in a minute. when the question was asked as far as lead time for planning purposes, to go back to full in person, how much time or notice would families need? Because we also know that what was great by having a different hybrid learning model for elementary, it's been hard on families no matter what grade level. But having a half day program at elementary, childcare has been a determining factor for some. So if you look at elementary results here, 56% of parents, they don't need any notice as far as returning. But we have 35% of the parents that said, I need a week or more. So we're here to say we're going to have a lot more than a week's notice. But at the same time, we knew it was important to provide that notice. At the middle school, 66% of parents said that they did not need notice. At the high school, parents still need notice. When we think about our older students, and still important for them to have that for planning purposes. So 35% of our parents would need at least a week's notice as far as changing in our learning models. Our students that are fully remote, these numbers here, the N factors here, so you can get an idea of the number of students that responded. These are our students that are in cohort D. So they are fully remote this year. I will tell you, we've continued all year to have students returning from being fully remote back into our hybrid model. And we've seen an uptick of that in the last couple of weeks. And some of the comments that have come back, it could be that they had older parents living with them, and now they've been vaccinated. And so they are able to send their students back to school. So completely, it's understandable when we think about the timeline of vaccines. Some families have many different reasons for starting to send their students back. Some see the writing on the wall that we're going back to full in person and see it as a way of, I can have my students back, because maybe it was daycare or childcare as a challenge for them with a half day model. So there's a whole host of reasons, but it's really important for our families to know that if they are fully remote, they can continue to stay remote. So across here, you can see at the borough, we had 14 families that are currently remote that responded to the survey, and half of them said that they would return to full in person. In that case, we had a high participation rate at the borough because we only have, as an example, 16 students there that are fully remote. And you can see across the different color charts there that it varies a little bit from those that will continue with remote learning versus those that would return to in-person learning.
I do think that box in the lower corner, Dr. Burdos, is important to point out the participation rates, because there, in many cases, we didn't hear from the cohort D families yet. We'll be hearing from them soon. So the numbers are a little, they need to be in context in terms of how many people participate.
Overall, so far, we had a small percentage when we think district-wide of students that are learning remotely, right at 5%. And we've had just even since the beginning of the year, a 17% decrease in the number of students that have transitioned back into our hybrid model. Here's what's really important to remember, that all of our health and safety measures and cleaning protocols and disinfecting procedures, they all remain and even are heightened as we look to bring all students back full in person. The self-checker, that really thinking about, keeping people honest, stay home when you're sick, think about what's on that symptom self-checker, not coming to school if you have multiple symptoms, the mask wearing. It's critically important. We have had our students do such a fantastic job of wearing masks. They really transitioned to it really well. We worried in the beginning, would they be able to do it? And they've done just fine. All of the cleaning and sanitizing in schools, our custodial staff, they really take pride in what they do. And it's made a difference in all of our buildings, having additional hands on deck, if you will, during lunch periods, if it's at the middle school and at the high school, or in between our elementary cohorts, and being very strategic in the cleaning that takes place. The disinfecting of buses in between runs, all of the procedures that have taken place whether it comes to the scheduling and the cleaning for the day, the plexiglass that's been installed in offices, all of those fogging machines, the electrostatic machines that are able to go through large spaces very quickly through classrooms and clean, and the additional cleaning that's just done in all of our schools every day. The classrooms to accommodate full in-person would be 3 feet in classrooms. It would be, in some cases, moving some of our classrooms, particularly at the high school, into some other locations and figuring that out. I'm not gonna get down into the weeds, if you will, as far as the logistics, because there's lots of logistics and planning in these next several weeks. Part of this is the furniture that we've taken out of classrooms already. We've substituted tables in classrooms for a desk. We've done that. So we also know that for lunch, we still have to remain at 6 feet because you have to take your mask off to eat. Same thing during snack breaks or mask breaks. You have to remain at 6 feet in order to take your mask off. In order for us to accommodate that, you think about right now, we have all of the desks that are in the cafeteria and the multiple spaces. For instance, if I give the high school as an example, we're using the media center, we're using the cafeteria, we're using another large space, and desks are there. To have students back full in person, we have to take those desks and move them back into the classrooms, but yet we can't go back to our cafeteria tables because of still having to maintain the 6 feet. So we're having to purchase additional desks in order to do that. There is a tremendous amount of logistics to be worked out, and that is the planning that's taking place now in order to figure out the lunch. That really is a major challenge, particularly at the high school, because we have to, and then at the middle school, actually all levels, because when we're eating in multiple spaces, then that provides additional supervision needs as well. Cohorting of students and having them in groups, obviously at the elementary level, they're already cohorted in a classroom. We see that at the middle school level, more so for fifth and sixth grade, where they're between the two teachers. And then at the high school, we've not been able, as you're aware, to cohort students because they move throughout the building just based on the nature of having multiple grades in different classes. You can have a ninth grader in classes with a 10th grader, again, different spanning different grades. Our special subject areas, as far as art and music and Spanish, we will be looking at having them come into classrooms versus going to additional classrooms because we're really having to think about space. Wellness classes, I know that our wellness department head was meeting with Jen Rosenberg just today and talking more about the spacing there with having more students back in schools. Obviously, we'll be accommodating classes outside when the weather is permitting. And then we'll continue with what we've had with one directional seating and having our tents come back that we had in the fall when it provided an outdoor classroom space, whether it was for music at that time, for the lunch area, we'd be able to use that for the high school. And again, just having an additional outdoor space. The other mitigation strategies here, I have this last bullet here, which is a physician letter. You know, some questions that have come to me from parents are, where is the research? Where is the science? Where can I find that? This letter is one that is on the Department of Ed's website. It's a list of over 300 doctors in different capacities, whether they're infectious disease, whether they are at Tufts, whether they're at any of the other advisory groups. And it spells out more of the research that has been done looking at studies in other countries and what has been done in Massachusetts and across our own country. And then really what are the effects of having social distancing, wearing masks and all the other mitigation strategies. And that is where they have seen that it is, again, based on the science and based on the evidence that it is safe to be in schools with masks, with all of those other mitigation strategies, with a social distancing of 3 to 6 feet. If you could have it at 6 feet, that's preferable, but to be in classrooms where students are learning at 3 to 6 feet. The other supports that are you know, not unique to Foxborough, but is something that we're very proud of, is that we do have really reasonable class sizes in any given year. So when we think about our spaces to be able to have students at the 3 feet mark, we've gone through, we've measured all of the classrooms, we've measured where students would be sitting at desks. We're moving furniture to see that we can have them in classrooms at that metric. Again, purchasing additional desks at all levels to be able to outfit lunch, to be able to continue at 6 feet, our previously conducted HVAC study. We've had an additional full-time nurse that we added this year for the purposes of COVID-related, you know, whether it's contact tracing, just additional support. And it has been something that has been truly needed this year and has been a great support to all of our schools. Right now, we had, as we had mentioned at the last school meeting, Ms. Edna Fuller, the nurse who was at the Taylor, who had retired. So Donna Jurdak, who is our floating nurse, if you will, she's gone over to support the Taylor School, but we are in the process of trying to replace her for this year to, again, have that additional support district-wide. Weather's changing, which is great. The availability of outdoor spaces will increase, being able to open windows like we did earlier in the year and having those tents will be some other supports that would be important for a full in-person return. A full in-person return is still a lot of planning, and I really can't underscore that enough. We have 3 plans. We had those at the beginning of the year as we were required to do. But with that, when we think about moving from a hybrid model to full in-person, you have bus route adjustments. Our transportation department has, you talk about pivoting, and with bus routes, they've done that and looking at now if the capacity being lifted, going back to those bus routes, thinking about what it would look like with everyone back in person and then not having the limits there. Elementary, we've been on a 5-day cycle, returning to a 6-day cycle when we think about our specialist schedules, which is, you know, music and art and wellness and Spanish. But it's also all of our service providers and their schedules. Those are going to change for students, because if you're full in person, you may have had services provided during your asynchronous time and now you're in person. So the schedules for specialists and service providers, there's a lot of work that has to be done there. All of the logistics around lunch or snacks or recess, those are all very real logistical problems that we are solving. Having our students that are fully remote, as I mentioned earlier, can continue to be fully remote. Thinking about our entrance and exit procedures, those are gonna look different by school. We have some additional challenges where more families are driving their students to school because of the limits that have been on buses. That has created some other challenges. So to have all students back, thinking about those entrance and exit procedures, particularly when at the high school, when you've got drivers on top of that. And then providing instruction to our homeroom classes as far as the schedules that go along with specials with our cohort D students who then log in for wellness or art or music, et cetera. Some of those schedules are going to change based on teachers now being in front of students during those time periods. There's some additional considerations for the high school when we talked about the MCAS and AP testing. So disrupting the schedule with that for that first week of May, the drivers, the lunch logistics, it really is, we have 3 lunches at the high school right now. We would have to move to 6 locations. So when you think about those locations, when we think about the cleaning, the supervision, because students are not eating in classrooms, as an example, at the high school, there's a lot to be done, but we'll be working on that over the next several weeks. And as far as the logistics of things, that is, a lot of work by Diana and Beth and Andy. And then I know that they also have, you know, others that come forward and it's thinking of different solutions and how we can do this, because the lunch part really is one of the biggest challenges to be able to overcome. food service, grab and go, thinking about how to expedite the food delivery to students in these multiple locations. Technology, with students back full in person, our students in kindergarten through fourth grade, their laptops will not stay home. They will come back and stay in the classrooms, and we'll have special charging stations of where they will be housed. Fifth grade through 12th grade, those laptops will remain with the students. They'll be turned in at the end of the school year, but they will be traveling or staying at home with students. And then, as I mentioned before, the capacity limits lifted for busing, which significantly expands the ridership. The timeline, I'm going to go through this part, and then I'm going to stop and questions. And then particularly, as you'll see here, that last Friday, the Board of Education granted Commissioner Jeff Riley the authority to determine when hybrid and remote learning models no longer count toward learning time. So these are the student learning regulation hours by law. At that meeting, by granting him that authority, he then can say, if you are asynchronous, if you're not in the building, it doesn't count. And if you're not meeting your learning hours, then you would be making those learning hours up. Giving examples of, is it going a longer school year? Does it go into the summer? All of these other examples, if you're not meeting the student learning time. At that meeting, he had said April 5th for K to five students to return full in person. We have been working with our Foxboro Education Association all year. They've been tremendously collaborative and working together with us for us to solve problems along the way, always keeping safety at the top. And we have planned to return our students before he made the announcement more official for our students. The intent is to return them by April 5th. Now, K to five is, when we think about Foxboro, a little bit unique in that our fifth graders are at a middle school. Districts in that situation could apply for a waiver to where fifth grade would not have to return at the same time as K to four students. And districts, it would have to be a school committee vote if we applied for that waiver in order to exempt grade five. We feel it's important to include grade five because it would provide an opportunity for us to transition the fifth grade where they didn't have our normal transition, if you think processes during the fall, to bring them back with K to four and to bring them back on April the 5th. Six to 12, it was actually announced today that they are required to be back based on Commissioner Riley's announcement by April the 28th, the Wednesday after April vacation. But our intent is to return grades 6 to 12 on the Monday after April vacation and to have them return at the same time. The 9 to 12 has not been determined by the Department of Education at this point. They said they would announce in April when the return date would be for high school students. We're looking to return our high school students with our middle school students on the Monday following April vacation. So as far as next steps, we held virtual town meetings for parents in the fall. We would do the same again, where we would be able to go over more logistical, school-specific types of questions and what it would look like in the buildings with students full in person, and then provide obviously an update at the next school committee meeting. An important piece, and then I'll stop to go for questions and have the elementary principals, if they have anything to add, is that we need to survey our families that are in cohort D to see what their intent is as far as returning, and would need confirmation of that by Friday, March 26th. This is important for teachers to be planning to know if they're going to have those students back in the classrooms. And if they're thinking of returning, what we also feel is really important is that they're returning at a time from an instructional academic standpoint that makes sense and will set our students up the most for success. So elementary students, if they were to return by the April 5th, when it would be the return of all students full in person. And grade five, again, to return April 5th as well, because that would coincide with the beginning of the trimesters. Grade 6 to 8, we would want them to return by April the 12th. So that would be, these are the fully remote students if they were to return. So they would be in hybrid for that week before April vacation, before it was a full in person, after April vacation, because it coincides with the fourth quarter, and the same for our high school students. We also realize that being late in the school year and being in the fourth quarter, that what makes it the most sense educationally for a student may not be to return to school, or they still have the reasons at the beginning of the year that they're fully remote. So again, if you're fully remote and you want to remain fully remote, you absolutely can. If we have families that with the full and return to school do not want their students to return full in person, they've been in the hybrid model, I would suggest to wait until our virtual town halls and to see what it's going to look like and to have those conversations. But at the same time, if we have families that do not want to return, they do have the option of going fully remote, but that would be just as it is with our other students that are currently fully remote, and that would be with the learning management system that we have through the partnership with the Department of Education. So I will pause there, and before I stop sharing my screen, just that last thank you to our nurses for their countless hours this year in supporting our students, our faculty, and our families.
Thank you. Committee members, any questions for either Dr. Burdos or the three elementary principals that are attending this evening? Brett?
Mostly just to summarize a lot of what you had just said, what does that mean for if the plan goes to fruition for those full remote Wednesdays? Would they be 5 days in or 4 days in?
The remote Wednesdays go away. We are back, I will say, normal under COVID situation. It's 5 days regular schedule back to school, 5 days a week.
Wow. Okay. Thank you for the clarification.
Kiara.
I have a question regarding what would be considered a close contact. Would that mean like if we're within 3 feet of another person that had it, if that makes sense?
Yes. No, that's a great question. And I'm so glad that you asked that because that is an implication that will change. Because right now, by having students at 6 feet, it really limits the number of close contacts. It would increase if you had a positive case. So for example, if you're sitting in a classroom and you have students that are, the close contact definition is less than 6 feet and for more than 15 minutes. So if you're in a class period and you're sitting there, then those students that are sitting in front of you, behind you, beside you, or diagonally would then be close contacts. So you could have a possibility of say 8 if you were sitting in the middle of a classroom. Now that's going to change based on the dynamics of a classroom. You could be in the front corner of the room as well. So that is something that we could potentially see more students that would have to quarantine because of close contacts.
Gotcha, thank you.
Michelle.
So I would say based on that, I'm just thinking, you know, in the high school, we're going into testing with the MCAS, we're going into AP exams. What's going to happen if, in a high school class, we're within 3 feet and you have 8 kids that now have to quarantine because they've been in close contact? Part of the reason I'm just throwing that out there is, you know, we've been getting not routinely, but every once in a while, we get a notice saying that, you know, one of my kids has had someone that has been positive in a class and not having to worry about it because it's a 6 feet situation. But now we're going right into those kind of AP exams. And I'm sure that there's a lot of juniors and seniors that might be a little nervous about that. What happens if all of a sudden they're a close contact and they've got their AP exam in a couple of days. Is there a way that we're thinking about that? Is the school, Massachusetts School Department, thinking about that at large?
I think that, you know, that question, like many others, are a number of the things that we're talking about. What would be plan B? The quarantining piece, we know that based on the revised guidance, it has shrunk the time period. So when we think of someone has been exposed, for someone who was symptomatic, and then they test on day 5, then they're able, as long as they're not symptomatic, are able to come back on day 8. So it has shrunk that quarantine window, but it still is a quarantine period of time. So we'll have to have contingency plans for that as well.
And are the teachers going to be, because I could see there may be more quarantines, especially in the high school, are the teachers going to help accommodate that so that the students get their work and don't fall too far behind being at near the end of the year?
Yes, I think, you know, I shout out to our teachers, and anytime students are out, we, you know, in the past it was students could be out because they had the flu or they've been out for a multitude of reasons. The quarantine piece, it is a challenge, and particularly if you have more. So, you know, some other technological solutions, what would that look like based on a quarantine circumstance? So we're thinking through what our situation is and what are some other possible solutions if it's a quarantine situation that might look different than what we've done during the other piece, the other parts of the school year for that reason.
Okay. And if you don't mind, I just have some other kind of questions to follow up on that. Is up to this point in time when the school day ended, it's kind of like the school was closed. So kids staying after school to make up tests, to get help with the teachers, that was all basically done remote. Is that piece going to change as well, where kids can make up some of these things after school as needed?
I think some of the questions that as we do our planning would be better answered in, like, say, the high school virtual town hall.
Right.
Be able to go through those. But I think that at the same time, we're going to learn as we go forward. We're going to have mistakes. Not everything's going to be perfect. We know there's nothing about this year that has been perfect. But what we do know is that students, from a mental health perspective, from social emotional, to be able to be back in the school building where teachers and staff can see them every single day, and to be able to better provide those resources and supports to them, will be able to do that if they're here 5 days a week.
I understand and completely agree on that. And that's, there's definitely, I just want to thank you for, that was a very thorough overview, explanation. There are a lot of questions that I have that I've been sitting here kind of ticking off, whereas you're answering them, that, you know, are the tents coming back? How are you guys dealing with fifth grade? All of those things, it's really helpful to see how well and how thorough everyone is looking at all of this. And we just need to anticipate there's going to be so many different nuances that makes it kind of out there. And so I appreciate that and thank you for that.
It's important to know, so including this week, when we think middle school and high school that have the greatest logistical challenges, we have 7 weeks to plan for this.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So there's a lot of work to do and a lot of logistics, but we do have, you know, this week and 6 more weeks to plan.
Right. And one thing I just wanted to kind of clarify, because I'm not sure that parents who are listening at home might fully understand, when you're saying that, okay, to count towards education time. So, you know, how I view that is the school department, the Massachusetts School Department, is really looking at saying, like, okay, if we stay in hybrid, the kids don't get to count those days that they're not in school. We, Foxborough, doesn't get to count those days towards the school. So we'd have to keep going to school, you know, through the summer, or there might not be enough days to make that up. Then we have education, graduation problems, as well as being able to I would assume, rise up to the next grade level because they won't have enough days. So it's really being mandated.
It absolutely is. It absolutely is. So when we think in a normal year, students have 180 days. They have 990 hours at the secondary level that they have to meet and 900 hours at the elementary level. So essentially that's about a 6.5 hour day on average, 5.5 hour elementary in order to meet that structured learning time. So the commissioner was granted, because of the emergency nature, to be able to say that if you're remote during the time or if you're hybrid and you're not in the building, that that would count towards those learning hours. It will no longer count toward that, and therefore you're not meeting the regulation, you're not meeting the law.
So thank you very much.
Thank you, Michelle. Rob?
Yeah, so Dr. Bertos, thank you. I would also commend you on the thoroughness of presenting what you have, and it's going to continue to evolve naturally. And Michelle, I want to, I was going to reiterate this, but you did it so eloquently around, we are still following within the guidelines and take our guidance from the Department of Education. This is not Foxborough acting independently. We still have to follow the guidelines that are set for us by at the state level. So I appreciate all of that. Back to some of the other questions, and I apologize if you said this and I missed it. From a budgetary standpoint and from an operational standpoint, what is the impact on our budget from a maintenance and custodial perspective? Do we have supplies that can support all of this? If we have our students back in school full time, what does the cleaning schedule look like? I know those are unanswered questions, or we're still developing those answers, but are we projecting any impact, positive or negative, to the current budgets that we need to accommodate and before, you know, we finalize? I know we voted on the next school year budget or the next fiscal year budget. Are there any things that we need to accommodate there?
There's definitely additional costs that are there, just as we've had all year. I think that Bill would be able to speak to it much more articulately because he's got all of the numbers in his head. Because he's living this every single day.
Well, I think, Rob, to your point on like PPE as an example, we did a great job planning for that at the beginning of the year, and we actually planned our way all the way through the end of the year and bought product. So we virtually have like a mini warehouse full of everything we need to get us through and actually into the summertime, because we're anticipating obviously summertime instruction as well for whether it's the extended school year or whatever. So I continue to work with our facilities guys. We're very confident that we've got that covered well. As far as staff, custodial staff typically does their regular cleaning. And the last thing that they do every single night is they go through every single room, spray them down, and let them go through the overnight process of making sure that there's no issues there. That will stay consistent. We will stay consistent with the additional staff during the day because of the lunchtime things. We've accounted for all of the staff changes that we made to get us to this point in the year to cover us through the end of the year right now. Mm-hmm. And again, based on the two grants that we've received so far this spring, we believe we have that covered. So it's not an additional impact to the taxpayers of Foxborough at this point. And it's, obviously will keep us within our budget. We anticipate, obviously, with this latest round of support that the federal government's doing, that there will be additional money for schools. And in that, we hope that that's one of the things that will be in there was the additional support for food service. Because as I told you before, that's not mm-hmm. running in a positive fashion right now. But they know that. They know all the school districts' food services are having a hard time because of the way this is run. So we think that's going to be covered and we should be in good shape there. As Dr. Bertos did mention, obviously to make this thing work smoothly, we do need to buy more desks. We looked at trying to do like plexiglass dividers on all of the cafeteria tables and stuff to manage the way the state said you could do that. The problem with that is the plexiglass, by the time we were done, was almost as expensive as buying the desks. And in the end, then what do you do with the plexiglass? It has no use. Where at least the desks, we can replace older desks throughout the district, and you know, use the newer desks as a upgrade to our any of our buildings as we move through here. So there was a lot of logical sense there. We made connections with the vendors early enough, and we have got commitment dates to receive the elementary furniture before the 5th and to receive the high school and middle school furniture over the school vacation week so that we're set for the 26th. Obviously, we're dependent on those schedules being met, but you know, again, we've already committed to that and it's already in motion. That, you know, expense, obviously, we're hoping will be covered in our next round of grant money that we anticipate seeing. And it definitely be one of the items that they would allow us to spend it on. So we're comfortable with that. So I think at this point, Rob, I think financially, we're relatively comfortable that we've got things covered. And with the few resources that we expect that will be coming, additionally, we think that will help us make it through for sure on some of these other items.
Bill, can I just say, I expected as thorough an answer as you just gave, but I think I've decided that there may never be a question that is actually going to stump you.
Yeah, no, there are plenty.
Then we'll leave that to Tina. That's now Tina's job.
Any more questions from the committee? Well, I do have a question. The elementary principals, you've been sitting here so quietly, so thank you for attending. And I want to ask this intelligently, but to offer what you have here to offer us. Any thoughts or your feeling or sense of some of the things you may discuss or put in place as you start to talk to the students and the teachers about unveiling the logistics? So logistics are one thing, right? But the conversations with our kids and our teachers is another thing. Do you have any thoughts about that you might have already started brainstorming? I'm not looking for black and white firm, but just ideas and your vision.
I think for sure what Amy said is it just the gift of time was great that the staff found out about this last Thursday, which gives us a month to think about this and consider all of the different things that are going on. I think for us getting schedules out, which believe it or not, we did have done last summer for the most part because we thought we might be coming back to school in September. So it's sort of, as Mr. Stan said earlier, and I keep using, dusting off those old schedules but then also having to make some adjustments, for example, for lunches, you know, whether at some buildings it's adding lunches or other buildings adding locations or a combination of. So again, I feel fortunate that we have a month to sort of work some of these things out as we go along.
I think one of the things that we've spoken about, what's different about coming back now versus starting a new year fresh, is that the teachers know all of their students in the A group. They know all of their students in their afternoon group. So it is a little bit different that those kids don't know each other yet, but it's nice the relationships that the teachers have already built with all of their students. And it will be important those first couple of weeks, that relationship building, the community building, and things that we took very much for granted up until a year ago, you know, choices we make at recess, you know, how we work in a cooperative group. You know, those things are things that we're making a couple shifts with. But I think what's really important to remember is that this is what we do. This is what we're wired to do. This is what our teachers are amazing at doing. So it is, although it's challenging, it's also really exciting for us to be able to get back to what we are here to do.
And I think all three schools, what we share is that we want to have, you know, safe, joyful, and engaging learning communities. And what we're realizing, though, is what may be possible at one school may not be possible at another, but the three of us work very well together in sharing and brainstorming. You know, I think Michelle talked about the schedules. You know, we each have our own logistical challenges because of size limitations. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we're trying to be as creative as we can, but as Dr. Berto said, you know, within those health and safety guidelines. And also, too, you know, small things such as, you know, how we deliver our curriculum, our math workshop, our daily five, how we have to sort of instructionally be very creative and be able to still meet the needs of students. But we're excited. I think, you know, that the energy in the building, you know, there is a lot to be done. But, you know, the children, we've had opportunities. We're looking at even starting this week to have the teachers take them out to recess, and just so they can see in that smaller setting with half the cohort and just be able to go over some expectations. We'll hold, you know, staff meetings, whether it's, you know, individual or with small groups or our entire staff, but also we'll hold, you know, mini assemblies with our students as well to share expectations for the bus, for the playground, for arrival and dismissal, as Dr. Berto said as well. I think the parent town hall will be able to share a lot of information and specifics about each school and how we're going to approach the reopening.
Thank you for those thoughts. Thank you all three for those thoughts and that perspective from your in the building leadership. Anything else? Any other questions? Tina?
Yeah, just before we move on, I did want to ask Dr. Berdos if there had been any, what's going to happen with the elementary schools with before and after care? Will we be able to accommodate the families that use before care for cohort, the morning cohort, and after care for the afternoon cohort? We're going to have space for them. And have we talked to the Y, and is the Y going to have availability? I know the child care is a big concern for our families, and this is going to be very different as people, you know, go back to work and the students are back in school for the full day.
Yeah. So I'll answer, and then if Bill has anything else to add. So for the day, our families that signed up maybe for the afternoon and they're in a morning cohort and now being full day, they want that afternoon. So Nancy Martin, she's reaching out already to families to find out if they want that, and we'll be able to accommodate them. The students that had originally signed up. We're not going to be necessarily taking on extra if we don't have capacity, but anyone with our current families will be able to meet their needs. At the same time, I actually been meeting regularly with Kim Jennings at the Y. She's the VP over all the child care programs there. And the Y has just, they've been a tremendous partner all along, but has also said whatever we need. I mean, even if we were short on staffing and needed help, they're there to help us. If we have additional needs for families, we're in constant communication. We actually met again yesterday. So there will be those resources for families. And I know the Y's reaching out too. They were just waiting to find out what's our plan and what is our return date. So I don't know, Bill, if there's anything else from our extended day that you wanted to add.
No, I think we're looking to try to return to a normal program. But again, to Dr. Bertos's point, it will be with the families that we are servicing AM and PM. If someone was in there in the morning and didn't need the afternoon because of the way it was split, they will get the option for the afternoon.
Okay.
And we've kind of looked at the numbers and we're comfortable we can make that all work. Mm-hmm. But beyond that, we don't believe we have much room to expand it. So.
Okay. But if you have morning and you need afternoon, if you're currently in morning and you need afternoon, that option is going to be there for you. And vice versa, if you currently have afternoon and you need morning. Okay. Yep. I think there'll be a lot of parents that are very happy to hear this information, and also that the Y is, you know, going to be very accommodating as well. So I did have one other thing, Richard, if you could bear with me. I wanted to circle back to MCAS just for a minute, because I think we do also need to emphasize that it's not just a state requirement, that the federal government and the new administration is not allowing states to even apply for a waiver for MCAS. So we have no choice, not at the town level, not at the state level. We have to move forward with this. And I hope our parents know that we will do everything we can. I know our administrators will, I know our administration will, to make this as the least stressful as possible for our kids. Because I think none of us really want to have to do this. You know, the testing is one more stress. I think right now, the most important thing is getting our kids back in school for their social, emotional, and mental well-being. And I hate to say it, but the academics are secondary. It's the rest of it that's the most important part at this point in the year. And, but we have to do this. And we're going to do it in the most supportive and nurturing and environment that we can. I don't know any other way to put it. And I know you guys will handle it as well as you possibly can under these circumstances. It's not really a question, just more of a comment.
Thank you. Anything else for? Well, great. Well, Dr. Bartos, yes, thanks for the update. And I'd like to reassure from my lens, at least sitting here with all of us this year and during the COVID pandemic, that what we've been able to do is adjust and stand upon our work in the previous day and previous week and previous months. And that's what I heard again today, whether it be the protocols and cleaning our buildings that we have not let up yet, and we will not let up, we'll be ready when we're in full learning, whether it's our investigation of the HVA system to where we were and where we are now, we're still in a good place for full learning. And then finally, you heard the elementary principal say, their preparations, their attention and their eyes on the ball for the students and the faculty. I expect that to be the same for all of our administrators. You've articulated that very well each time that you presented all these things. So there are challenges for individuals and pockets of people in every community, in every school community, differences and different needs. We all respect that. But I think our base foundation that we have put forward and set up and that we continue to lead in our buildings and in the administration is pretty solid. So I hope the takeaway for the community watching is that we got our eye on the ball. Actually, you have your eye on the ball with us together, and we're in the game. So I just hope people recognize that, and we're going to try right up until the end and until we have to. So I appreciate your report, and I appreciate the principals being here to support us as well. Thank you all.
Thank you guys. Thank you very much.
Kiara had to leave to do schoolwork, but I just wanted to say thank you to Foxborough High School. Each class came and decorated the three elementary schools in the Ahern on Read Across America Day. They wanted to come down and spread some sunshine. So I just wanted to say thank you to Foxborough High School for doing that. The students and the staff loved it. So kudos to the students up there.
Thank you. Thank you, Michelle, Mike, and Kate. Thanks for being here.
Thank you.
Next on our agenda is the curriculum review cycle discussion. And Dr. Mello, I think you're going to lead this topic.
I am. So as you know, we've gone through a couple of iterations and modifications to our curriculum review cycle due to the pandemic and due to some other challenges that have been presented by DESE. One was that the health and wellness curriculum frameworks had not been released, partly because everything was stalled due to the pandemic. So we had moved that off of the curriculum review cycle in hopes that we would have the new frameworks before we entered into that process so that we'd be well informed. So with that, typically our curriculum review cycle gets updated when it comes to its conclusion, but that would be at the end of next year. But because we are still on pause with the wellness frameworks, because we also have a new curriculum, K-8 curriculum director. And there's been a lot of talk about some updates that came out in the 2017 English Language Arts curriculum frameworks. We wanted to move that up and continue to hold off on the wellness. So what we're proposing to you tonight is just a complete fresh start of our curriculum review cycle a year in advance of it so that you can see the entire scope of the cycle in its totality for the next 10 years. So what we're proposing is that next year, we would engage in a review of our English language arts K-12. And if you remember, there has been some work done in project-based learning at the high school level. And this would be a great opportunity for them to assess how that's going. Should it be expanded? Where are we with that and our goals? And as we said, for the K-8 with our new curriculum director, to dive into that and really see where we are. And then that would just be a switch with science, technology, and engineering, which was scheduled for next year. There's not we have sort of the same situation where the bio test that was supposed to be updated and released in, I think it was this year, is postponed to 2022 because of the pandemic. So that would, again, it would better align with the things that are coming out of DESE. So what you have in front of you is the proposal of the order of the reviews that we have. One change in this curriculum review cycle from previous curriculum review cycles is separating the musical arts from the visual arts. And both the department heads, when I spoke with Cammy and Kelly, they both felt good about that. They really liked the placement in the cycle. They're excited about it. So we feel like this is going to serve us very well in terms of what's coming out of DESE, the timing that's coming out of DESE, and where our needs are as a district. So with that, I will make you happy, Richard, and hopefully I'll take up less time than was scheduled on the agenda and entertain some questions. You do have the previous review cycle for your reference as well. So whatever questions you have, please.
Thank you. Any questions for Allison? Oh, great. Well, I think that's that. So thank you very much. Dr. Bertus, do we need a vote for this to adopt it? I was thinking we do. Yes. So I would like to have a motion to accept the 10-year review cycle as submitted. 10 years, right? I had 10 years, right? Yes, 10 years as submitted.
Second that.
Who was the first?
Reuter.
Reuter was first. I thought that he said second. So anyways, so Brent is motion that, and second is
I'll
Michelle. I see a hand up. Thank you, Michelle. By Brent and seconded by Michelle. Any more discussion about the review cycle? I'll just say thanks again for taking a good hard look at it, repositioning as necessary. Curriculum views are not simple. There's complexity to them and planning that goes into it. A lot of work from the faculty as well to put it in. So the getting the input of all the curriculum coordinators, of course, is what you would do, but that's always very valuable and it helps to, you know, put that design together for our forward thinking as a leadership team of the school committee. So thank you for that. Brent?
Thank you.
No, I just wanted to add that I think that I've supported all of the shuffling of the very purposeful and ordered changes in curricular review throughout the whole setting. And I'll remind everybody that one of the district goals and strategic, I guess, initiatives of the district is furthering inclusion in an anti-racist initiative. And so should faculty and administration in the upcoming years wish to privilege that in further edits to the curriculum review, that would be greeted with very open eyes and ears, at least from the school committee's standpoint. So please keep pushing that as an aspect of your strategic goals. Thanks.
Thank you. And just so you know, Brent, that is actually included in our curriculum review process. It's actually a new addition based on the work we had from our committee. So that's a huge piece of auditing our curricular resources and thinking about that perspective when we are going through the process, as well as the technology implications being embedded into that process as well. Because in the past, those have been a little bit more separate. So that's a really good point. Thank you for raising it. And Richard, thank you for pointing out how much effort and thought goes into this from the people, the right stakeholders in the school community. They were really eager for an ELA curriculum review. So it's really exciting that we're able to accelerate that so that we can really meet the needs that they have been.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Any further questions?
No.
We have a motion on the floor. So I'll do a roll call vote, seeing no more questions. Tina?
Aye.
Brent?
Aye.
Michelle?
Aye.
Rob?
Aye.
And me, aye as well. 5-0 vote for proposed curriculum plan. Thank you very much, Dr. Mello.
Thank you, everybody.
I think the final agenda item, I guess before other matters, is the third reading of the policy for assistance animals. I'm not sure, Dr. Bertus, did you want to introduce this or the policy subcommittee?
Yeah, I'm good either way. So this, our subpolicy committee, you want to talk about it, or would you prefer that I introduce?
Brent or Michelle, any thoughts?
Either way, I know we've read the policy into the record, and I just want to more as an overview state that the additions, shifts, and changes to the policy reflect school committee meeting thinking back in March of 2020, a year ago. And they weren't substantive. It was more stylistic than anything, and that we were poised, frankly, to pass this policy, but then were stymied by the blessing that is COVID. And so that we're mostly, this is a reflection of us returning to business prior to COVID.
Yeah, thank you, Brent. I appreciate that. And I think there's a lot of things that came into play. Correct, more stylistically, a few nuanced questions about the time frame for the animal and involving with the police department and discussions, and then the school environment was a totally different place. So I think we've been through a few of those things during this period of time. So we're just bringing it back.
Thank you.
I think first of all, do we need to motion to move to not read it again? Would that make sense, or is it because it's the third, Tina?
Well, we would have to waive the reading. Yeah. We'd need a motion to waive the readings. And I guess my only thought
so moved.
That Michelle hang on a second. Michelle was on the committee. I'm sorry, Brent, when we read it the last time. Mm-hmm. And so I'm not sure. This is actually the first time something like this has occurred in the 9 years that I've been on the committee. So I don't know if we have to reread the whole thing or not. I would say probably not, but I don't know if Michelle would like to hear the whole thing.
Well, Tina, what I would say is because I'm on the policy committee, I've read this. And I know that we have looked at it while I've been on.
Since you've been on. Yeah.
So I don't feel like I need to have it read in.
Okay. But I'll make a motion to waive the reading myself.
Second. Is motion to waive the reading a second to waive the reading?
Yeah.
A second? Anyone?
I think Brent seconded.
Brent, yeah, second. Though, thank
although,
you very
although,
much.
Although if Mr. Canfield could second either.
I'll second it for the second time.
Okay.
No, I'm conscious of the fact that I'm on the policy committee.
So fine. So we'll go with Rob as a second. Thank you very much. Any further discussion on to waive the reading? Seeing none, I'll do roll call vote for that. Tina?
Aye.
Brent?
Aye.
Michelle?
Aye.
Rob?
Aye.
And me, aye as well. So 5 to waive the reading of the policy. Thank you very much. Would anyone like to motion acceptance of the policy as submitted? Brent, as a motion.
Not
second
me.
On that motion. Michelle, thank you. Any further discussion on the policy as we have before us?
I think I will just add before we vote on it that I think this is an appropriate time to be voting on this, that possibly if we get this in place, maybe we could have some, you know, when we have stressed out students and coming back into school and dealing with a lot of stuff, this might be a good time to have this accomplished and perhaps get some assistance animals in just to, you know, help with testing and acclimation back to full days. I don't know. So, but yeah, that's my thought there.
Well said. Thank you very much. Excellent.
Right.
Any final comments? Good. I see none. So we'll move the question. Roll call vote again for the assistance animals policies IMGA. Tina?
Aye.
Brent?
Aye.
Michelle?
Aye.
Rob?
Aye.
And I as well. 5-0 vote for the policy IMGA. Thank you. Thank you all. And thank you to the policy subcommittee for working on that and teasing any of the final details out. Really appreciate it. I think the final agenda item is our other item. Anyone else? Would anyone in the committee like to start under other?
No.
Oh, there we go. Look at that. We made it through. Dr. Burdos, please, anything?
Just remind folks that it's daylight savings time this weekend to be able to turn your clocks.
Yeah.
So it's just exciting. You know, spring is in the air. We're talking about students coming back full in person. We have warmer temperatures. We're going to see a little bit lighter days. So it's exciting. It's just, I'm really excited of what's to come.
Thank you. Dr. Mello, anything?
Yes, I just wanted to mention that I was working with the elementary principals this morning, and parents should watch for information about our upcoming kindergarten information night for our incoming kindergartners. We will be having kindergarten screening as we typically do. So those dates, watch right. for those. And the town hall meetings that Dr. Burdos mentioned earlier, watch for those. And just lastly, just even talking about curriculum review and some of the meetings I've been in, it's really exciting to me personally, and I think to our team, to just really talk about teaching and learning again and the work that we're here for. Not talking about hand sanitizer all the time and actually talking about what we do. So that was great. So thank you.
Thank you. Do you have any thoughts? Any final thoughts? Great. Tina, did you have another thought?
I actually wanted to ask how the CIP meeting went on Saturday before we go. My apologies. I meant to ask
okay.
before, and I meant to watch it, and I didn't. So my apologies there. But
Tina, yeah. That's on point. That's on point. That's great.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I know we're so close to being done, but so what happened? At CIP.
It was a very different meeting being that we were all virtual. So
right.
The logistics of that, which you think we're used to by now. So really fortunate in that we, if you remember last year, we only had the minibus that was funded right. and we typically have two school buses. So three school buses
good.
Supported. And then also mm-hmm. if there were additional funds that would possibly come through grants or something to that nature.
Yeah.
If the funds were there, that to the fourth bus that is needed,
good.
That would be supported. But through the CIP, it would be the three buses,
mm-hmm.
The 30,000 for Bill. Am I remembering that correctly for the copiers? 30,000 or 40,000? I don't have it in front of me. I'm trying to remember.
The cop, just yeah.
And yeah. In addition to the copiers, the buses, the technology, if we remember, we typically have 200,000 and that was cut in half to 100,000. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, we've been able to use the CARES Act funds for so much right. of the technology.
Right.
So to be able to couple that, but to still have the 100,000 for the technology needs that are going to be very present. And that's, you know, obviously district wide. What was not funded was for music. If you remember, we had kind of a three-year plan.
Right.
That's being deferred. So there were a number of other items from across the town that were mm-hmm. deferred to go forward.
Yeah.
We were very thankful to be able to have go forward what we did. And Bill, anything else to add?
No, I think that's, I think we did as well as we could do. And I think that will support what we need to for the next, fall, for the next year.
Good. Thank you.
Thank you for that. Thank you for Tina that mentioned that. Good. I see nothing else. The final thing I would just, Brent, did you have something?
No, it's a follow-up on the CIP thing. Are there other streams of funding for the music, instrument and infrastructure replacement that people are aware of?
That question actually came up during the CIP meeting, and the
sure.
reality is there's really no grants. As you know, we go after pretty much every grant we can find.
Yes, you do.
There's no grants really relative to music programs, at least that we've seen.
Okay.
We have been fortunate in the past with, the sponsorship by the Foxborough Music Association, who really does do a great job. Putting together a lot of funding for different music, needs. But we're talking sure. about stuff, this is really a $175,000 3-year plan. It's very large equipment. Some of it's, $10,000 for a unit. So it's not something, yes, could they chip away at it? Potentially, but we haven't, we really think that this is something, these are items that last 25 years or have lasted us 25 years in the past and really are town assets that need to be kind of purchased in this fashion. But, obviously we have taken gifts from families. Tina was gracious enough to give us something that one of her sons was not using anymore.
Right.
So we try to do that as much as we can, but there's just not a lot of options for this.
No, and Ms. Shiyukina, that one of the reasons, I mean, it's a very pointed question. I thank you for asking it so, or answering it so directly as you usually do. And that's more just for families at home, just to say that, like, in tough times, and when there's a lot of competing interests, if this is something that you find of value as a family, reach out to your music department and see if you can help out. And that's all I'll say about that. So thank you, Mr. Yukna, for being so direct in your answer as you usually are. So thank you.
Thank you for that. And I do hope we'll consider to keep that door open for next year when CIP comes around too.
Hear, hear.
I think it's probably necessary because I understand exactly what they're trying to accomplish and it's pretty important.
It is.
So thank you.
Right. Richard, I would add one more thing just for the group to understand. We've typically, if we have money at the end of the year, we prioritize different needs within the school department. Mm-hmm. Not that I'm saying that we're going to have money at the end of this year, but if we were to, last year, one of the items that was on this list was the risers, which were a safety issue. And quite honestly, when it comes to safety, that's one of our first priorities. Sure. So we were able to click that off, you know, and get it done, and still return about $375,000 to the town. But that was just one of those items we didn't feel we could wait any longer on from a risk point of view. So I think that's, you know, one of our options that's always out there, you know, in a time frame if we have funding to do it. So it's not going to be something that's lost on us, but it's also, you know, we have to consider the times for the town as well.
Yeah, Bill, that's perfectly well said. And I'm glad you said that because I certainly have experienced it personally myself in my role as a music director. But one of the things that these 3-year plans have is they have it's on paper what it is. And so when there's an extra $5,000, they can go buy the baritone saxophone for $5,000. So that is the advantage to the detailed preparation of this type of plan at any given moment. That there's a budgetary opportunity, so it works. So I appreciate you. That is a very good assessment and good eye on the ball because it can happen. It can happen, absolutely.
Oh, here, here. Thank you.
Thank you
for that.
So I was just going to close by saying thank you to everyone for tuning in tonight. But I did want to leave us with something I've said before. We got to pay attention to where we still are. We're still in the pandemic and we're still in March of the pandemic. So we are making some wonderful progress. About full in-person learning, and that is progress, and I'm very excited for that. I think we all are, but I don't think anyone said tonight, let our guard down, and just good not point. Where we want to go. We have too much positive and too much energy going forward, so let's not hit the brakes, and let's not turn the wrong corner. So thank you all for being, and thank you all for tonight, everyone, for helping out and supporting this meeting. Motion to adjourn by someone?
So moved.
Tina, motion to adjourn.
I'll second it. Second.
Oh, wait, Tina got first.
No, I got first.
No, Brent made the motion. I'll second Brent's motion.
Fine, Brent motion, Tina second. Thank you. We have motion. Roll call vote, Tina.
Aye.
Brent.
Aye.
Michelle.
Aye.
Rob.
Aye.
And aye for me as well. 5-0. Motion to adjourn. Thank you all and have a good evening.
Thank you.
Night.
Night, everybody. Thank you.